This is something that I've been involved in for the past 3.5 years, more or less, and I expect to be involved in a formal sense for at least another year, but then it will probably go on beyond that as well. That is to document and inventory the locations of stone constructions throughout the eastern seaboard of the US and Canada. And then to share this information in a couple of different ways. First of all, with the state historic preservation offices and the tribal historic preservation offices throughout the region, and secondly, with the general public. Though the ways in which the latter will be done will be a little different, because I will only give site-specific locational information to the tribes and the SHPOs, so as to deter the possibility of vandalism at these sites, which is a very real problem. Let's see if we get anything. Something happening. Have we got power?
Yeah, we'll try.
Okay. Has to be turned on. Oh, it needs a battery. Our concept.
I'll be your click person.
All right, so this is not working. All right, so we go back to the more primitive. Okay, get the next one, please. Okay, so, well, it's an introduction. And I want to go to the next one. Okay. I want to talk a little bit about how I got involved in this project. Back in 2003, there was discussion in the Narragansett Indian Tribe Council concerning their observation that a number of the sites in Rhode Island of which they were aware as sacred sites were going under the bulldozer. And they had a debate. And some of the members of the tribe thought that they should not do anything. They were aware from their perspective that these sites have sacred associations and sacred power, and that if the white folks wanted to reap the negative consequences of destroying these sites, why just let them? And the other opinion, which eventually prevailed, was let's see if we can maybe find some partners in the communities with whom we can collaborate to see if we can allow for the preservation of these sites. So once that second opinion had prevailed in the tribe, they then began to reach out. And they reached out first to a group of amateur archaeologists in the town of Carlisle, Massachusetts, or in that general area, who were aware of a number of fairly extensive stone construction sites in their area. And they called me in at that point because we knew each other. And I met with the woman who was at the time the tribal medicine woman, and her son-in-law, whom some of you know as Doug Harris. And we took a look at some sites, and we decided that something needed to be done. They also then took their concerns to the larger body, which is known as the United South and East Tribes. And this comprises the federally recognized tribes from Louisiana to Maine. And United South and East Tribes, or USET, has issued a number of resolutions concerning these sites and expressing their belief that these sites are, in fact, and this is their words, prayers in stone. And that, well, you will see that in this document. I can't read it, okay, whatever. But it's there, it's on the web, you can find it. So that was something that broadened my perspective on this, to realize that this was something that was a larger phenomenon than just in southern New England. And so I decided at that point to undertake a project to inventory as many of these sites as I could, and then, as I've said, to disseminate the information. Next. So there have been a number of ideas out there about what these things are. Many professional archaeologists consider that they are the result of discard by colonial farmers clearing fields. Or that they may be staging areas for the construction of stone walls. Or, one of my favorite dumb explanations, an attempt at aesthetic farm maintenance that is supposedly in the early 19th century as lands opened to settlers in the much richer soils of the Ohio Valley, the local farmers, in order to try to keep their kids from moving out west, young man, invited their neighbors in to create fancy stone structures, lacing the neighbors with grog as they did so, and that was the origin of these as a result of what were called stone bees, or what Robert Thorson has called the farmer's doodling, which if you know anything about farmers, they don't have the time to doodle, but be that as it may. We also have a number of people, particularly in the New England Antiquities Research Association, who would like to see these things as being archaeoastronomically aligned to key points in the horizon, solstices, equinoxes, and so forth, possibly by non-indigenous peoples that supposedly came across the Atlantic from time to time, or the native explanation that these are prayers in stone. So these are a number of hypotheses. I'll throw one more out at you that I heard more recently, which you just have to love this. This came from an archaeologist responding to a rather productive site of this sort in Pennsylvania, who claimed that the stones had rolled downhill and self-organized into piles. And if you believe that, or you've got this real nice bridge in Brooklyn, I'd like to sell you. I mean, yes, and they also rolled uphill onto the tops of the hills, too, huh? Yeah. All right. So, next. Well, it turns out that we have some historical evidence for the native construction of these. This is a story that is found in the History of Martha's Vineyard from 1923 concerning the first Baptist minister to the natives on Martha's Vineyard. John Mayhew Jr. They really liked him there, and so they built him a stone pile. And when he found out they were doing this, he said, no, don't build it for me, build it for Jesus. And they said, well, okay. And then he took a group of his converts to England to show them off, and his ship sank in the Atlantic with all hands lost. And when the natives found out about this, they continued to build up the pile. And there's a photograph of the pile from at least 1923. The author thought it was a bit dilapidated, but still it was there. I don't know if it's still there.
Yeah, it's still there.
It is. Okay. So that is an evidence of a contact period pile built by Native Americans for a white person. Next.
Some of the dialogue on the vineyard, I happen to live there,
yeah.
is based on he transformed a lot of the Native Americans into praying Indians.
Yeah,
and exactly. They're all buried on this hill right beside that.
Yeah.
But if there's a path that goes through the woods, where there's all these stone structures,
yep.
To me they look like early winter burial structures where you can't penetrate the ground,
yeah.
And you can store people's bodies.
Possibly.
There. But the whole area is Native American.
Right.
So they built everything.
Where on this continent isn't? Right? And this is from...
No, all this is saying that there are stone structures built at the contact.
Right. Oh, yes. I agree with that. And here is an account of James Oglethorpe, the founder of the Georgia colony, who got really friendly with a local Native chief named Tamachechi. And when Tamachechi died, Oglethorpe had a stone pile built in his honor. So now we've got white guys building stone piles for natives. So this is going on. And we do have numerous other accounts from the 17th and 18th and 19th centuries of native people continuing to build stone piles. And I'm here to tell you that they haven't stopped doing it. That location in Carlisle, Tim Fall, Doug Harris and I went out there early on in this process, and we mapped and recorded every single pile we found. There were quite a lot of them. Then Doug brought a group of the USEP folks out to the site, and after they had come and gone, Tim noticed that there were more piles there than we had mapped. So this is an ongoing tradition. They haven't stopped doing it. Next. And one of the pieces of evidence that suggests this is when you find stone piles which go across boundaries. So this is a map from James Gage's work showing sites or individual, each dot is an individual structure located in a location called the Parker Woodland in Rhode Island. And what I'd like you to notice is that these piles go across this dashed line, which is the boundary between Kent and Providence counties. Now, Kent County was separated from Providence County, I believe, 1723. So I can't imagine farmers wanting to farm fields in two different counties and pay taxes to them. So this is further evidence that suggests that these things are there before the county lines are put in place. Next. So I did a little bit of statistics on this to see whether or not we could say that these piles were clustered. So what this does is I imposed a 500-foot square grid over the entire site, and I put a count from Gage's map of how many structures there were per 500-foot grid square. And this is the result. And then I did some statistics on this that shows that the variable mean ratio, I'm not going to bother you with a formula, is 3.62, which indicates that they are clustered. That is not an accidental placement, as you might expect to find if farmers were just trying to get rid of this stuff. We'll see more of this sort of thing later on. Next. So that's the background. And now I want to get into the project methodology. Next. First of all, I established a boundary for the project area. Excuse me, I'm getting over a cold. Thank you. I decided that I would only look at sites that were in river drainages that flowed into the Atlantic Ocean, rather than to the Gulf of Mexico. And so I went from the St. Lawrence south to the St. John's in Florida, though I quickly found out that there are no stone piles in Florida, for the very good reason that there are no stones in Florida. All right. So my furthest south site is, in fact, that pyramid of stone that Oglethorpe built in Savannah. And Savannah is located right over here. So that's the project area. Now, I know that there are plenty of structures in West Georgia, Alabama, Tennessee, which I did not include in the study. Somebody else can do that. But this is my project area. Next. So I created a spreadsheet, actually two spreadsheets, showing a number of different parameters. First of all, I assigned sites arbitrary numbers within each state, the name of the site, the town, the county, the state, and then the actual location using the universal transverse Mercator system of numeration rather than latitude longitude, because that's what archaeologists use. I have redacted those columns, all right? So you will not be able to see where the sites are. Elevation above sea level, proximity to water source, what is the name of the water source, what major drainage is it in, and stream rank, for those of you who don't know, a headwater stream is rank one, where two headwater streams join, it becomes rank two, and so forth. By the time you get to the ocean, you are up at rank eight, but it doesn't go higher than that.
Proximity to water source in feet?
In this case, no, meters.
Okay.
All right. And a reference as to where I got the information. Next. And then a couple of additional parameters, such as the soil's fertility, which I got out of the Natural Resource Conservation Service information, which is available through GIS. The distance to the nearest fault, the distance to the head of tide, I'll explain that in a moment. And then the distance to the watershed edge. And this is measured at three different levels. One of the hints that our native friends have dropped for us is that a preferred location for these sites is a location where water flows in two directions. And a watershed, which is the boundary between two river drainage systems, is exactly that, right? But it occurred to me that another place where water flows in two directions is at the head of tide in river systems that are close to the ocean. And so I played around with head of tide data as well. And then these three levels of distance to watershed, the six one are major watersheds. So like the Connecticut, the Hudson, things like that. The level eight are major tributaries of those watersheds, which might have differences between them. The level six could include much smaller boundaries between, or boundaries between much smaller watershed systems. And so all of that data was obtained through GIS. Next. And then there's another spreadsheet that ties into what you saw before with definitions of 18 different types of structures. Cairns, rock piles, stone rows, U-shaped structures, subterranean structures, standing stones, split boulders, balanced rocks, marked stones, stone circles, effigies, inscriptions, and there's a couple more that are on this slide, mounds, platforms, and niches, and then the ever-popular unique structures. All right? And I also, where possible, recorded azimuths as to where these things might point if that had been recorded. And I then have a column that has the total number of structures at the site, if known, and that's a bit of a problem, because as you can even see here, in some cases that's not known. So it just says something was present, or there were several, or many, or a few, or some, and that's a little indefinite. I hope to clear some of that stuff up in the future, but be that as it may, that's how we do it. And then a final column for the number of different types of structures present at the site. So those were the baseline, and then I funneled that information through my GIS specialists in order to get the parameters out. Next. So we want to take a look at how good are my sources of data. Well, I have five different categories of places where I went to look for data. First of all, and foremost, I talked with people who know